They lived there as farmers for almost 30 years, adding more children, about a dozen in all before they were done, working hard until even there the Civil War caught up with them. In March of 1863, Congress passed the Enrollment Act to provide fresh manpower for the Union Army. It required men between the ages of 20 and 45 to register for the draft, and each congressional district was responsible for meeting a set quota of troops. Through the wonders of the internet, you can actually see, and I have, a scanned photo of a page from the original handwritten record book, listing the names of draftees from Berrien County, including four of James's sons, their place of residence, their age, their race, their occupation, their marital status, and their place of birth. At this point is where the family legend takes over, because the Enrollment Act had an out for those who wished to avoid military service. Instead, a draftee could pay $300, a little over $9,000 in today's money, or provide a substitute to fight in his place. So according to the family legend, James Jones paid for three of his four draft-eligible sons to stay home from the war. But then the money was gone, and there was still one son left. So the legend goes, James himself became the substitute and joined the Union Army in his son's place. Of course, it's pretty much impossible to verify if this legend is true, but records do show that James enlisted as a member of the 1st Michigan Sharpshooters when he was in his early 50s and no longer eligible for the draft himself. If the legend is true, we can only imagine what his sons might have felt as they watched their father go off to war while they stayed home. And we can only imagine what they felt when they learned of his death. Because the records also show that James A. Jones was killed in action on May 6, 1864, in Virginia, at the Battle of the Wilderness, a battle which took place about 100 miles from Frederick County, where he had been born, in the state he had left almost 30 years before. There is a family grave marker in a cemetery in Berrien County, Michigan, that I am hoping to see in person next time I visit. According to the marker, James is buried somewhere in Virginia where he died. His sons, however, lived on into the 1890s or early 1900s, and so far I have found no records that any of them ever served in the Civil War. So if the family legend is true, it seems that James made a choice in 1863, a choice which has directly impacted my own life over 100 years later. Because Sanford Leroy Jones, who lived in Berrien County, Michigan in 1863, age 20, white, a farm laborer, single, born in Michigan, would have been the fourth son to be drafted, the son for whom James substituted himself when he joined the Union Army. And Sanford Leroy Jones was the father of Raymond Richard Jones. And Raymond Richard Jones was the father of Leo Raymond Jones. And Leo Raymond Jones was the father of Laura Lee Jones. And Laura Lee Jones is the mother of me. Now, I am 100% sure that James Jones did not have me in mind when he made his choice. As a parent myself, I can suppose that his own children, their safety and well-being, were his immediate concerns. But I can also say that I am 100% grateful that he made the choice that he did. Because if it had been otherwise, you would be here listening to someone else, someone giving a completely different sermon. And if you think that they would have done a better job, well, then I apologize. Actually, just blame James. But I find the older I get, the more I become convinced that stories are the way human beings make sense of our experiences. We use stories to explain our lives, why we are the way we are, why we do the things we do, why we make the choices that we make, and and maybe even how our lives fit into the greater human story. Some of the stories we choose to tell can give us life, how we overcame great difficulties to become more whole, more compassionate to our fellow human beings. But the stories we choose to tell can also bring death, how we are fundamentally flawed and broken because of something that happened to us, and so then we act out of shame and fear of others. I get the feeling that Jesus must have been aware of the power of stories, because so many of his teachings have come down to us in that form, stories that were heard and retold many times in many communities before finally being written down generations after the time of Jesus. The result was the first four books of the New Testament, Matthew, Mark, Luke, and John, the Gospels we have today, as well as other collections of stories, other Gospels that were not included in the Bible. The parable of the sower, as today's gospel reading is usually called, is one of those stories. As we read about Jesus, we find that when he wanted to show people what the kingdom of God is like, he healed someone or ate with someone his culture said he wasn't supposed to. And when Jesus wanted to describe what the kingdom of God is like, he told a story. The kingdom of God is like a sower who went out to sow. Now, this parable is somewhat unusual in that later in the same chapter in the book of Matthew and in the books of Mark and Luke, where versions of the same parable also appear,